2016, we're going to open our meeting this morning with a prayer from Reverend Carmichael from the Nature's Coast Hospice. And good morning, sir, and we're going to, the pledge will be led by Commissioner Flagg this morning. Everyone rise, please. Good morning, sir.
Father, we're so thankful for each day of life that we have. And again, Father, life is a gift. Father, thank you for people here who love our county, leaders who love our county and always seek the well-being of our county, Father. And we just pray today, God, that you would guide, Lord, that you would give wisdom. Father, we're so thankful for Putnam County, God, and all the wonderful things that have happened in the past, Lord, and the bright future that we have. We thank you, Father, for the country that we have, the United States of America, Father, your gift to us. And we thank you for preserving the freedom that we have and ask that it might be continued as well. So bless today, Father, and may your will be done, Lord, but help us always to follow your leadership. And thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Citizens, please join us in our Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands,
one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Reverend Carmichael, for being with us this morning. Thank you, Reverend / Commissioner Flagg. Commissioners, in front of you, you got the minutes from the March 22nd regular meeting. I will entertain.
So moved.
Second.
A motion and second. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Ayes carry. Thank you. Okay. Mr. Leary, I think you have item three this morning.
Yes, sir.
And good morning, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. At this time, I'd like to invite Alan Peacock and his family and Chief Romay to come forward and meet Chairman Lible at the podium, please. We've invited Mr. Peacock, we've invited Alan to come be with us this morning on the occasion of his retirement. Alan is the fire marshal of the emergency services. He started with the county in 2006. He's retiring with 9 years of honorable service to the county, and we certainly appreciate the work that he has done in helping to keep the citizens of Putnam County safe. So Alan, we thank you and wish you well in your retirement.
A token from we commissioners, it's a Putnam County pin, and of course the plaque. And, Alan, any words you want to share with anybody, or Quinn? This man's been in fire service in Putnam County a very long time.
And, I'll say one thing real quick. Alan started his career in the fire service down in Crescent City. As a business owner, he would leave there and he served the citizens of Putnam County for over 40 years in the fire service here. So he's been in many different roles. He's helped us tremendously in fire protection and fire prevention. And we're going to miss him, but I think Judy has a few little chores she wants him to do. So see how that goes. But he's definitely been an asset to the county.
All right. Go ahead, Alan.
Yeah. Appreciate this recognition here. It seemed like yesterday started out the volunteer service here, and it's been a haul. Met a lot of good friends, made a lot of good friends throughout the county, and really enjoyed working with everybody. And already booked up for my first week of retirement. Got a Go help take care of the Tallahassee grandkids.
All right.
getting started. Thank
like
you.
Like a priority.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, while you all are
taking pictures. Can we get the other EMS representatives to come and be a part of this photo?
Yeah.
They're here, and they worked many years together with him, and I think it would be befitting if they would just come and join in.
Mr. Chairman.
Stand like we do?
Yes.
Yeah.
And Commissioner Harris, floor
recognized. I just wanted to say I have served with Alan in Crescent City and served with Alan here, and what a good person he is. He's always doing something for others and so capable. And thank you, Alan, for your many years, both places.
Want us to join?
I do, sir.
Commissioners, let's join them.
Yes.
Put Alan in the middle. Alan in the middle. Are we all centered a little bit?
They need to shift, but we're pretty good.
I'll have to get real friendly.
Friendly.
Can you go to the left just a little? Okay.
Me?
Okay. No. Let's lift you up a little bit. You okay?
Yeah.
Put it on panoramic.
There you go.
All right. Good deal.
One time.
Mr. Chairman, I'd also like to say it has been a pleasure working with the chief. And he has made Putnam County proud and a better place. And thank you so much again for your services.
And a speedy recovery.
Yes.
At this time, we'd like to invite Bob Hatton to come forward and join the chairman, and Larry Gast, the solid waste director. Bob, you have any members of your family with you?
Me.
All right, well. We've invited Bob to come to be with us this morning so that we can recognize and congratulate him on the occasion of his retirement. Bob has almost single-handedly been fighting mosquitoes here as the director of mosquito control for the last 12 years here in Putnam County. We certainly have appreciated his efforts in battling those mosquitoes, and we want to wish you well, Bob, in your retirement. Thank you very much for your service over those last 12 years, and congratulations.
Thank you. Commissioner Harris has some words for you, Mr. Hatton.
Bob, we appreciate your service, and you're one of those people that always goes a step beyond and always figure out another way. I think you worked on bees or hornets or something in addition to the mosquitoes, and you just did a lot of extra things. And if we had something like for the Rotary Club, for the Catfish Festival, or the Swine and Wine, you were always there to help us spray so the event would be good. And just on your own time, thank you so much for all you've done, and we hope that you have a great retirement.
We refer to you as the employee we never see.
That's right.
He works at night spraying for mosquitoes.
Daytime, too.
Yes, you too. Here's a pin,
thank you,
Bob, from the commissioners. And
excuse me.
Stuck to me. Are you going to explain this contraption you brought with you here this morning?
I thought you'd never ask. You're going to be seeing these around the county. This is a special trap that was developed by scientists in Germany for specifically to capture the daytime biting mosquitoes, the Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus. The aegypti is for sure the Zika carrier, and we suspect that the albopictus will also be the Zika carrier. We've requested some more of these from the state. I will say that the governor has been on the spot, getting an anti-Zika effort going in Florida. He's got a task force. We're part of the task force. We're going to have these traps up around the county, and we're going to be emailing in the number of Aedes mosquitoes that we catch each day. It's just a matter of time before one of these mosquitoes with Zika start spreading it in the state, more likely down in South Florida, but who knows. And anyhow, this trap and the ones that we have like it will be our sentinels for the Aedes mosquitoes in this county. And I don't know if people in the audience know this or not, but Putnam County is blessed in many ways, and one of our blessings is that we have probably one of the few, if only, solid waste director in Florida with a degree in entomology, Larry Guest, who used to be the entomologist for the Cape Canaveral complex. And he really knows mosquito control, and will be directing the new technician who we're interviewing right now for the job. So you're going to be in good shape. Putnam County is not going to let you down as far as this thing that's happening. Another nice thing about it is that these mosquitoes are called house mosquitoes. And the reason they call them house mosquitoes is that's where most of them are, right around your house. Within, 1,500 feet of your house is normally where they are. So you can fight the Aedes mosquitoes that bring the, possibly bring dengue and Zika by cleaning up your yard and your neighbor's yards and keeping particularly tires from people throwing tires out. You can be part of the solution.
Thank you
for giving that.
You're good. Go that.
Now, I'd like to say that Bob is one of those employees that every employer wishes they had a dozen of. The kind of employee that does whatever's asked of him, no matter what. We'll be able to fill Bob's position, but we won't be able to replace Bob.
Well said. Well said.
Hold that down a little bit. You're blocking Nancy.
Uh-oh.
There you go. Thanks.
Poor Nancy. Bob.
Thank you.
Okay. On the agenda next, we're going to call on our property appraiser, Tim Parker, to come forward. We switched them.
Good morning.
Morning. Morning.
Thank you for this opportunity to be here this morning. After 37 loyal years of service to three property appraisers, Ed Brooks, Larry Pritchett, and me, and more importantly, the citizens of Putnam County, Mrs. Patsy Bennett will be retiring at the end of this month. I would like to personally thank her for her years of service, and would also like to thank Coach Bennett for sharing her with us just a few more years. March the 19th, 1979 is when Pat Bennett started with the property appraiser's office. She obtained her Certified Florida Cadastralist designation April 20th, 1989, and has been an integral part of our office since the very beginning. We often talk about institutional knowledge and the benefit it brings to our office and our citizens. Although we will never replace that, Pat has prepared us as best as possible for her departure. Her rapport with area surveyors has been invaluable to both them and us, and has enabled our office to do the best job possible with the information provided. So it is with heavy heart that we say thank you for the exceptional service to our office over the years. We do not expect Pat to be a stranger to our office and want her to know that she is welcome to continue sharing her knowledge with us as time permits. We have a certificate that reads, "We hereby express our sincere appreciation to Patsy W. Bennett for outstanding service and contributions to the citizens of Putnam County for 37 years and award this certificate from Putnam County Property Appraiser, Palatka, Florida, this 12th day of April, 2016. So join me in thanking Ms. Bennett.
Good morning, Mr. Pritt.
Morning.
Nice to
see you. I say, as I said earlier to Tim, it does feel like old times. Not my first time before this board, but I got to tell you that since the 1970s, when your predecessors met on the third floor of the courthouse, things have changed a little bit. I knew that when I came in through that security, and I thought, things are a little bit different, but anyway, this is a pleasure. It means a great deal to be able to say a word or two about Pat Bennett. We were fortunate to have her services. Putnam County was fortunate. She came to us with old-fashioned work values, which are actually sometimes scarce these days, but she put in a full day's work. She came to work early. She stayed late. You had to ask her or she wouldn't take any time off. We'd be open on Saturday to take homestead exemptions, which her duties did not include taking homestead exemption applications. She came to work anyway. If the office was open, she was going to be there, and that's the kind of employee she's been. And her interaction, as Tim's Parker just said, with the local surveyors solved so many problems for Putnam County over the years. She's just been a reservoir of knowledge. My guess is we're going to still have to call her from time to time for information. But this is a lady who has done a lot of important things in terms of survey knowledge and legal descriptions and mapping and over the years, and we're going to miss her. I know that. It's good to see you all, and thank you very much.
Good to see you, Larry.
Thank you.
In case anybody was wondering, this is Mr. Larry Pritchett. He is the former property appraiser here in Putnam County. It was nice to see you today, sir, and especially with your former colleague. Mrs. Bennett, congratulations. I appreciate your many years of service, and I had the honor of you waiting on me a couple weeks ago, and Larry's right. You get it done right then. I expected to come back, but you said, no, let's do it right now. And we did, and I thank you. Commissioner Harris.
I don't mean to talk so much today, but I have to say something. Ms. Pat has been helping me in that office since the mid-70s. And always, if someone couldn't find it or someone couldn't figure it out, Ms. Pat could do it. And you have been such a wonderful blessing to all of us. Thank you.
I would be remiss not to say how grateful we are for the many, many years that our family and your family and how you have served this community, and may the work you do continue to speak for you. Thank you.
All right. Okay, Ms. Linda Myers, our tax collector, is on the agenda next. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
Great. Thank you so much for the opportunity to be with you this morning. If I can start by inviting up some staff from our office, your tax collector office. First of all, our honoree, which is Trish Foster. Trish, please join me. And also Brenda Bridges, our Director of Operations, and Patsy Treadwell, our Director of Motor Services. Please join me. And Brenda, would you do the honors of telling everyone about this fabulous public servant?
Good morning. How are you
morning,
this morning?
Brenda.
Trish Foster began her career in the tax collector's office as a title clerk in 1991. She was assigned to the Palatka office. In 1999, she received her designation as a certified Florida collector assistant by the Florida Department of Revenue. In 2000, Trish was promoted to branch supervisor and assigned to the Interlochen branch office. In March of 2014, to the dismay of many of the customers in Interlochen, we moved Trish back to the Palatka office because of the talents that she had, and she was needed desperately in the main office and is now the customer service representative coordinator for all of the customer service representatives in all three branches. In 2014, Trish was also recognized for her assistance, dedication, and hard work with the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission, the Vessel Inspection Committee, for her participation and input during the drafting of proposed legislative bills, as well as her participation in the creation of a vessel inspection training program for Florida Wildlife Commission officers statewide. Please join our team as we congratulate and thank Trish for 25 years of outstanding service to Putnam County.
Again, the tremendous service we have from the Putnam County employee staff and the constitutional officers make a difference every day in the lives of our citizens. So, Trish, we just thank you so much, and we thank Interlochen for sharing her with us.
Thank you.
Picture.
Mr. Chairman, while they're doing that, if you don't mind.
The floor is yours, Mr. Commissioner Harvey.
Trish, thank you. For the audience that doesn't know, Trish and I went to elementary school together at Mosley. We would beat it after school to the ice cream truck that was parked down the road, so we remember that fondly, how we would run to the ice cream truck immediately after school. So, Trish, thank you, and thank you for all the work you've done.
Thank you. So, the opportunity to present in front of you guys gives us It's an opportunity to talk about our specialty tag of the month. So on your desk, you will find a little tag. And Mr. Smith, could you read it to us, please?
It says, "Ask me how you can help save and improve lives." I'm waiting for the answer.
And the answer is donate life. It is organ donation month. So tax collector offices, when people renew their driver's license, are the source of over 50% of the folks who sign up to be organ donators. So it's just an opportunity for us to highlight a tag, of course, and there is a Donate Life tag, an organ donation tag that we're highlighting this month. But we want to remind folks that a simple choice you make when you renew your driver's license or when you initially get it to be an organ donor, it's easy to do, and by the way, painless. So we look forward to anybody has questions about that, and I presented those. And if we have any organ donors in the audience, I brought a couple of extra pins, and I certainly want you to have the opportunity to wear them today and celebrate what your gift is.
So, and, yes, sir. One question, what is painless? What did you mean by that?
Well, you're not around.
We wouldn't have anybody in the audience either.
Exactly true, Commissioner.
That is a true statement if there ever was one.
And finally, I just want to give you a quick update on your concealed weapons permitting opportunities in Putnam County. You know that about 2 months ago, we came before you and said we would be beginning the process on March 9th. We are one day short of 4 weeks in the stats you have, and we have averaged over 34 a week. 136 concealed weapons, either originals or renewals, were done in the first 4 weeks. So we are processing them every single day. And Commissioner Leibel, can I ask you was that painless?
It was painless.
So you were one of our very first recipients of an original application.
I was the first.
So, yeah. I think you were.
And it was fast.
So we certainly want to invite anyone who has questions. And some of our staff have some handouts. So on our way out, if you would like a handout on the simple process right here in Putnam County, just raise your hand and we will pass them out as we leave. Again, thank you for the opportunity to share with you 25 years of great customer service from one of our own, Trish Foster.
Thank you, Linda. Okay, next on the agenda, Mary Garcia from the Putnam County Health Department. We welcome you this morning, Mary. And
she's got the whole department with
her. Yeah, you've got an entourage.
Right, an entourage. I hate to travel alone.
Who was reading this morning? Who would like to take that, commissioners?
Doesn't matter.
I don't have a copy.
Okay,
yet.
Commissioner Flagg. We have a proclamation.
Oh, there it is.
Thank you. Putnam County Proclamation Number 2016-26, recognizing April as Sexual Assault Awareness Month. Whereas prevention and awareness of sexual assault is a community problem that depends on involvement among people throughout the community. And whereas rape, sexual assault, and sexual harassment harm our community. And whereas we must work together to educate the community about sexual violence prevention, support survivors, and speak out against harmful attitudes and actions. And whereas effective prevention and awareness programs succeed because of partnerships among families, social services agencies, schools, faith communities, civic organizations, law enforcement agencies, and the business community. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed that the Putnam County Board of Commissioners hereby recognizes the month of April as Sexual Assault Awareness Month in Putnam County and calls upon all citizens, community agencies, civic organizations, faith groups, medical facilities, and businesses to increase their participation in an effort to educate the community, thereby preventing sexual assaults and strengthening the communities in which we live. Be it further proclaimed that the Board of County Commissioners participates in and supports all persons in making a conscientious effort to prevent sexual assaults. Mr. Chairman, I move that this proclamation be adopted.
Second.
A motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The ayes have it. Congratulations.
Thank you. Tough topic, but I appreciate your proclamation today. Nationally, 1 in 5 women and 1 in 71 men are raped at some point in their lives. And 1 in 2 women and 1 in 5 men experience some type of sexual assault nationally. In Florida, the numbers are the same. It's a reminder that 63% of sexual assaults are never reported. We're very fortunate in Putnam County. The health department has a violence intervention and prevention team. Our rape crisis center has served over 150 survivors who were child victims of sexual abuse, adults who were molested as children, or sexually assaulted adults. In addition, our sexual violence helpline has received over 30 calls since it was established a few months ago. Putnam County is also fortunate to have a strong integrated services team to assist survivors of sexual assault of all ages through a combined effort of our county's sexual assault response team. The SART membership includes representatives of the Child Protection Team, Department of Children and Families, the Palatka Police Department, the Putnam County Sheriff's Office, the Putnam County Medical Center, the State Attorney's Office, and the Sexual Assault Nurse Exam Program, as well as the Health Department. We're also available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for any survivor who seeks assistance. And I wanted to recognize my team and officers from the Sheriff's Office who are on our sexual assault team with us today. So I thank them for all their work that they do. They're incredible.
Kodak moment.
I think so. Okay. And then each of you has one of these very bright pink ones, if you will refer to them. Nancy, you can stand right behind me because I'm much taller than you.
All right, it's a deal.
Okay, next on the agenda we have Craig McLean and Sam Carr, if you could come to the podium, please. We have some good news, county related.
Chairman, Commissioners, always a pleasure to be here. I want to start out and just say we've got some exciting news to share with you. You've probably seen a little bit, maybe heard a little bit, but we'll run through this. Are you seeing the image on your?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. No, we
got it. The subject of today's update is the St. John's River to Sea Loop Trail. I first want to take a moment and step back about 30 years. That's probably about the time when many of you were first exposed to the concept of maybe a rail trail or a multi-purpose path. At that time, the image that you see in front of you essentially had none of the green or brown lines on it. The brown, which may be a little hard to see, represents an existing multi-purpose path in the state of Florida. The green represents a vision to connect all those. So recently at a meeting, a few of us were afforded the opportunity to see some presentations from seven branches of the state regions that were promoting their area to be the next regional system to receive some significant state funding. Traditionally, these types of projects are funded through federal enhancement, gas tax types of revenue. So this extra state enhancement or investment is above that. So the subject again is the St. John's River to Sea Loop, which branches from, if you start in St. Augustine, come this way along the rail trail path to East Palatka, south roughly around the Highway 17 corridor, to DeBary, DeLand, and then down to Titusville and back up to Daytona Beach and up the coast back to St. Augustine. And St. John's County will follow the path clockwise. A lot of opportunities there, a lot of exciting work going on there, led by the VeloFest group, St. John's County Commission, working to develop a safer community in their cycling and multi-purpose systems. Flagler County as well. Most of their portion of the River Sea Loop is completed along the coast. They also host and sponsor a number of ecotourism activities such as the Spoonbills and Sprockets. It's a long-distance bike ride. In Volusia County, kind of the, in some ways, the seat of the effort with this River to Sea Loop, very strong program with their developed rail trail program connecting to their Springs to Springs Trail, which will be the portion that will connect to south of Crescent City. Brevard County, Space Coast, an exciting area. A lot of work going on there to connect their system. And they're part of an existing system I'll talk about in a minute called the Coast to Coast. And of course, Putnam County. A lot of effort put into this over the last 25 years, developing our hub system of our trails throughout the state, and many activities that we do through our Putnam Blueways and Trails citizen support organization, whether it be on the blueways, paddling, hiking, equestrian, and cycling. This effort started about 8 years ago. The five counties got together and developed a memorandum of understanding, and through that time we've had a real strong relationship to develop this River to Sea Loop. This River to Sea Loop will consist primarily of off-highway, or what some folks would call a separated facility, so that you're biking or hiking, rollerblading on a facility that's physically separated from the highway. Provides a lot of extra safety aspects. These types of non-motorized facilities come in different shapes and sizes. Many times they're adjusted to the constraints that an area may have, just due to space on the roadway, developments, those types of things. So a lot of work goes into that. There's always an operations and maintenance component of anything that you do. We have an opportunity here in Putnam County with the strong leadership of the Putnam Blueways and Trails CSO to be an involved part of that and help provide the leadership and guidance to move our programs forward. One of the areas that provided extra ranking in this process was the multimodal transportation opportunities, or these interconnections and links. In DeBary, there's the brand new SunRail station that provides a connection for the intrastate connection on that rail system. And in Palatka, we have our Amtrak station, which the rail trail is basically adjacent to. A big aspect of this and the promotional points is where our trail system was ranked high was the tourism and economic development aspects. Just a little shot of the Space Coast with some history. Draws a lot of people to our coastal regions. A lot of investment have been made and commitments to move this process along. This system contains, I believe it's like 5 or 6 scenic highways through the corridor, which add to the program. And one of the other measures of the trail success was the organizations and the effort of the coalition, in this case of the 5 counties, their readiness to move forward. So we ranked high there as well. I'm gonna take a moment and just focus on some Putnam County aspects. About 8 years ago, this 5 county coalition, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, was formed. At this, about the same time, Putnam County adopted its own trail master plan. That master plan has been in effect. This River to Sea Loop is consistent with that vision, and that's going on. Then the heart of our vision was, in this aspect with the River to Sea, was being competitive in regional tourism. I'll talk a little bit about that. On this River to Sea Loop, there have been a number of already held events. The Bike Florida organization has held at least 2 7-day bike rides along the route. There have been numerous bike rides and festival type events like the one that we just held this weekend, the Palaika Bicycle Festival. Our neighbor to the east, Armstrong, has held its 4th annual Rails to Trails Festival along the corridor. So just an example of some things that are going on as far as tourism. 3 years ago, a pair of legislators, one in St. Petersburg and one in Titusville, got together and kind of coalesced this idea of this coast-to-coast trail, which links St. Pete and Titusville. That trail was ranked first initially in the legislation 2 years ago, and in that, they've been receiving the bulk of the funds. With this new approach that's called the Sun Trail System, they decided to approach it a little bit differently. The legislature, this past session, not the one we just ended, but last year, so it would have been this past July, established legislation that would appropriate annually $25 million towards these types of trails in Florida. With this program, they broke it up into 3 pots, and these 3 pots are important. The first chunk of the money, about $8 million a year, will go to the coast-to-coast trail to finish the gaps there from St. Petersburg to Titusville. And then the next one, the St. John's River to Sea Loop, was ranked to be our next regional system. It will receive, beginning 2 weeks ago, when we were awarded the $8.3 million for this project. Now that work will be shared in the cost amongst the 3 counties and the pieces of the gaps we're trying to close. And then the last part of that pot, funding pot, are what's called the individual trail gaps. And this is important because there are sections that don't fall within the River to Sea system, say for example, going west of town on the Palaika Lake Butler section of the trail, that will apply for funding for this section. So in essence, Putnam County has the opportunity with the River to Sea designation to have ability to tap into 2 of those buckets, which is important for our continuing our program. So on March 31st at the Florida Greenways and Trails Council meeting, which is an entity that the state of Florida creates to provide recommendations on how to proceed with the state's greenways and trails system. Her testimony, presentations, and then they voted and ranked the St. John's River to Sea Loop as the next system to be funded in Florida. We're real excited about that. A lot of work has gone on the last 8 years to position ourselves to be successful, and this is definitely something that will move us in that direction. The next steps, we need to continue to strengthen our coalition in our 5 county region. We'll be working to share that annual $8.3 million budget. One of the blessings with this approach is that DOT will be providing the leadership and the oversight and the guidance, which is very important to help keep these types of projects moving. And the goal is to complete this trail within 5 years. As the work continues, we'll need assistance from the county and the cities of Palaika, Pomona Park, and Crescent City. We'll definitely keep you in the loop. Again, I'll touch base on the individual applications. We will be asking for some assistance in putting those applications together to continue some of the corridors from Palaika towards Lake Butler. We also would like to put in an application that would close a gap between Palaika and Hawthorne to the Gainesville to Hawthorne Trail. And that's more of an assessment, corridor alignment at this point. We'll take a moment to give you my sincere thank you to this commission and the cities. For 25 years, we have not had a commission wane in the support of this trails effort, so we duly appreciate that. Thank you for all your support. We'll be asking for some more help, so stay tuned. And at this point, we'll take any questions, and I'll leave the map up if you have any questions. I know Sam has a few remarks he may want to make. So,
Commissioner Harris.
I just want to say thank you back to you and Sam and the Rails to Trails people and the Blue Ways and Trails, all of those that volunteered to help keep this together and get it going. You all had to go to Tallahassee not long ago to present this and speak for us, and you went, Chip, too, didn't
yep.
you? Anyway, thank you, those leaders that stepped forward, and you, Craig, thank you.
Thank you, Craig.
Thank you.
Sam Carr is, I think you're the newest member to our Greenways and Trails Council?
No, I've you're been not. There for about 2 years now, and I didn't sign up for this duty, I promise you that. It was, when I got the invitation, I said, who in the world would put me up to serve on this council? When I got to the council, basically all we did was approve designated trails and that kind of stuff, which was cool. That was fun and all that, and listened to a lot of presentations. And then all of a sudden, the legislation passed this legislation in 2015, and it got real serious. And so for the past 6 months, I have looked at and had to scrutinize a bunch of different regional trail routes, and it's amazing how all this has come to be. The money is there, and it has to be spent every single year. So, you know, the significance of this designation as the River to Sea Loop is huge. So I serve as the governor's appointment as a Greenway user to this council. So I had to kind of stand back, and in order to be impartial, you know, on this vote, I had to kind of be in the background on this thing. So it was really interesting. But I sat there and listened to presentations by the Florida Keys Overseas Heritage Trail, the East Coast Greenway, which includes six counties from Fort Pierce to Miami, the Southwest Coast Regional Trail, which includes seven counties that goes from St. Petersburg all the way to Collier County. The Heart of Florida Loop, which includes Orange County, obviously, and Marion County and seven other counties. The Tallahassee Nature Coast Peace Greenway, which involves 12 counties, and the Capital City to Sea Trails, which involves four counties. And the St. John's River to Sea Loop encompasses five counties. And I'll tell you, sitting there at the council watching seven counties from the east coast of Florida represented, it was amazing. It really was. And they had a representative from every single county. And from same thing on the East Coast Greenway, they had somebody from every county from Fort Pierce to Miami at these two meetings, not just one, but two meetings. And but knowing what the River to Sea Loop was, I felt like we had done all this work previously. And these guys were really scrambling to get their packages put together. But the presentations were awesome. But Putnam County shined in this effort and so forth. There were two votes taken, and the River to Sea Loop was not the most popular in the first vote, but it was in the second vote. And so we really appreciate that, and it was really good to see that. But I just wanted to give y'all an idea of perspective on what the competition was and how big this is. There's 3,500 miles of priority trails in the state of Florida. And that's just amazing. And this will be an ecotourism destination for forever if we get that stuff done. And there's a plan to get it done, actually, out there. So congratulations to Putnam County. They were very well represented, and the work that has gone on for the past 25 years finally showed up. And I was talking to a representative from Collier County, that's Naples. They got money. And I was talking to them, and they said, we came up here thinking this would be a slam dunk. Nobody could compete with Southwest Florida Trail System. She said, we were blown away. just absolutely blown away. To the idea that this has been a dream of people's for all these years, and now it's finally coming true. So congratulations to
Sam,
the county.
Putnam County could not have done it without the passion of you and Craig.
Well, yeah. Craig is there the way.
Quite a few, and you do have us shining in the spotlight of trails in the state of Florida. And well, ranking high for the monies to be spent in the future, and well, we have you
thank
to thank.
You.
Thank
well,
you for
no,
thanking
thank
us,
you.
But let's give him a round of
okay.
applause.
Okay.
While we're on the Gay, you want to give an overview of the weekend's bicycle festival? And bring your helper with you. Are you on the public comment? Well, that's why we're on the subject. Let's go ahead and do it.
Yeah, since we raised the issue of the Palatka Bicycle Festival, we'll sit here and give you a real quick report out on that. It happened this past weekend. You'll see him from the event flyer, April 9th and 10th, just occurred. I thought I had recovered sufficiently from this whole weekend being involved in this until this morning. I went and put my garbage and recyclables out of the street and realized that trash day for me is Wednesday. So I had to haul it all back up to the house. Because, yes, I was like totally a day off in my calendar. I'm Kevin Sharbaugh, 114 Riverview Drive, East Palatka, Florida. I'm the current chair of the Putnam Blue Ways and Trails Citizen Support Organization. I wanted to just give you a brief update on our recent event, the Palatka Bicycle Festival. Our ride director was Mr. Penn Mitchell. He's our vice chair of the CSO right this moment. So I'd like to specifically thank him for all the work that he put into making this a successful event. We had some co-hosts with this particular event included Palatka Main Street. We also had sponsors including Beck Automotive, and of course the Tourist Development Council. The reason I bring them up is you'll see them on the back of the little flyer. These flyers, there were a couple of thousand of them that went out to a whole bunch of different bicycle ride events, basically in the southeast region. So that's the word going out there. Putnam County, Palatka, Florida, bicycle trails. Come on down and enjoy the space.
And bike
shops. Oh, and bike shops. Oh yeah, it was in a bunch of all the bike shops we could think of in the southeast. Or in Northeast Florida. Northeast Florida, sorry. That's a lot of bicycle shops in the Southeast. Okay. So it was 2 days. There were three rides per day, including a century ride on Sunday, which is 100 miles, but ours was actually 103 miles. And it went down through, it was on in East Putnam, went down to Wallaca area and looped around over to Crescent City and then came back up and up through Hastings and everything. So it was a pretty scenic ride. I wanted to say that we had 50 volunteers help support this event, and the hours that have actually been logged through our website of those volunteers is 500 hours. So that's not even all the hours that were contributed, but that's the hours that have people actually then taken the extra step to go and log their time on our website. That doesn't include two weekend work days that we did in preparation for this festival where we did cleanup of the new section, the East Palatka Trail. There's a lot of legacy tires. We heard earlier about the mosquitoes and tires. We collected just around 2 tons of trash, which included an awful lot of tires over those two work days. And there's still some tires out there, trust me. But we got a large number of those on those two work days. So my thanks to all those volunteers that helped out with that. We had 80 riders participated. I'd say the average age was around the 50s. So when you think of bicycle riders and doing 100 miles, in my mind, I think of young people in their 20s and 30s. But in point of fact, our participants are actually a little bit older than that. And I know that when we start talking about, you know, Putnam County needs to have more retirees with disposable income visiting and living in our community, I'd point out the fact that, hey, these are actually those people riding $1,000 bikes, more than $1,000 on some of these bikes, to come down here and take advantage of the nature that we have to offer for them to enjoy. So I just wanted to point that particular metric out to you about that. Special thanks to two of our commissioners. One is Chip Leibel. The riders all said that there was great signage for these routes, and he helped us with some of our sign work. And of course, to Commissioner Larry Harvey, who came out on Sunday and fed them pulled pork. So to the members of his church, I'd say Mr. Harvey might have missed Sunday morning service, but he was out feeding the multitudes, and we are extremely grateful to him for that.
Excuse granted.
Yeah, you know, it's, you know, you got to get down into it. So we also, this year, we offered a number of extra activities that people could participate in. That was in conjunction with Miss Mandy Tucker. She's with the River Center and the Bronson Mulholland House. So we worked out a cooperative deal where we trained some of our volunteers as docents for those two locations so that in exchange we could actually have those locations open to the public over the weekend and also make use of the River Center. And so everyone who came and visited was really impressed by the River Center and the facilities that we have here. So let's see, I think the last thing I want to say, I'm going to read you a quote from one of the participants. His name is Dutch Hoffman. He's 61 years old. He's out of Orange Park, Florida. He sent this in this morning to our Facebook page. He said, "For me, this was the least boring, most scenic century with a few climbing challenges that I've rode in either 2015 or 2016. It deserves an A. Try to do it next year if you've never ridden this route. A big thanks to all of you." So that's the kind of experience we want people to have. Because that'll get them to encourage their fellow cyclists and their different clubs to come out next year, and in the interim to just come down and enjoy some of the nature that we have here in Putnam County. So thank you very much.
Before you leave the podium, I want to quote, I think, a phrase that the group has adopted, "Bicycle, Putnam County, Florida, where nature and history meet." That is so well said, and what you just said, and the appreciation of our trails, right. They are beautiful. Shaded oak canopies all through, just, we got the best on this deal, I think.
Yes, my name is Gay Esperson, 114 Riverview Drive, East Palatka. I've been wanting to come and talk to you since last fall, when we had Paddle Florida come through, and what I wanted to do is say that the community is very supportive of what we're doing, and I really, really appreciate it. I was in a panic on Saturday morning trying to find someone to drive a county van to move people from downtown down to Salt Springs. And I called Chip, and Chip returned my call, and I was like, "I need a driver. What do I do? And he pointed out that Linda Meyer, this was on Friday morning, pointed out that Linda Myers might have a driver, and I drove over there, and she ran into me. I said, "I'm panicking," and she found a driver. The county pulled through for us, and it's been multiple times, and it moves me to be able to live here and get the support from you all for what we're trying to do. That was a very hectic weekend. And I really appreciate all the support we got from you for that. Also, I want you to be aware that Putnam Blue Ways and Trails is doing multiple things. The Bicycle Festival is going to be an annual event. We've been supporting the Iron Horse Run as volunteers, and we've been asked to become the support system for that run. We're trying to decide if we want to do that or not. We've created an adventure race in the fall called the Kai Hike a Bike, which is kayaking, running, and bicycling in Willacka State Forest. We have one of our board members is so enthusiastic about this. He put it on last year. We had 20 participants, and he wants to make it bigger and better this year. So Putnam Blue Ways and Trails has become an organization that's bringing large events to the county on our trails, and it's grown. We've only been around for 4 years, and I'm amazed at how much we've actually done in those 4 years. So I want you to be aware of what we're doing, and I want to also thank everybody for helping. Also, we needed rest stops all over the county. Crescent City pulled through, Pomona Park pulled through, Georgetown pulled through, the Ag Center pulled through. Thank you, Rick Leary. And that gave us places to set up our tents for the rest stops for this event. So I want to thank, basically this is a big thank you for everything you do for us, and it encourages me to press onward even when I get tired and grumpy. So
well,
thank you.
With our last speaker, you know, thank you for thanking us, but your tireless effort, right. it cannot be matched. And this commission, we thank you.
That's right.
With that being said, we're going to recess for 5 minutes. We'll be back at about 10 o'clock. 2016. And on the agenda, we're going to go to the public comment portion of the agenda. First off, we'll be speaking will be Faye Sparkman.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Is it possible to please ask our honorable clerk of the court to come here to the podium?
Oh, my. It's up to him, I reckon.
So granted.
They go through security?
Ready? This is Mr. Tim's special day from the women's and the citizens of this county, and now she's going to read something special for Tim Smith, then Wanda's going to pin him.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
Whereas this is the 12th day of April 2016, whereas we are currently participating in the second Tuesday's regular Putnam County Board of Commissioners meeting, whereas all notable Putnam County elected officials are present in this meeting room, and whereas Clerk of Court, the Honorable Tim Smith, is amongst the notable elected officials in attendance, and whereas we the citizens are at this podium to recognize the Honorable Tim Smith for being the best hugger in Putnam County, we hereby present the Honorable Tim Smith with this award, Best Hugger in Putnam County.
The best hugger.
Wow. Impressive.
I've just been notified we have a phone call, and it's Tim's wife. She wants to know what's going on.
Just a minute, Spark. We got to turn to you.
They say run.
All right, thank you.
This was just a fun day, so Mr. Flagg, we're teaching you. You're next.
Really?
We have to finish teaching you first.
Oh, my.
Well, normally when someone gets recognized, you let them say a few words.
Okay.
So I think what I'll do is I'll set up a table back here, and maybe we can raise some money for the March of Dimes. So a dollar a hug, and we'll just be here all day. And I'll be the recipient of all the great.
Well, I see.
Thank you so much.
Congratulations, Tim.
Oh, my.
Can I just give you a dollar?
Yeah, a dollar for not hugging.
All right, it's getting awfully mushy in here. Karen, come straighten us out, will you? Karen Chadwick, next on the public speakers.
Probably not going to straighten out anything. Karen Chadwick, 179 West Strickland Road. Since this is a thank you day, I wanted to thank Commissioner Leibel for having the meeting when the Riverkeeper was here, and looking at the big picture, the excursion was 310 miles and included a lot of the tributaries, and I go to a lot of meetings with Lisa, get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and travel all over. And I know she loses a lot of family time, and she really is genuine about getting the water cleaned up and keeping it clean. It's not just about Rodman. You know, there's a much bigger picture, and I really appreciate you getting such a good group together. And I was happy to be included in that, and representing Putnam County Environmental Council. We get a lot of glares, but we mean well. What we do is for the good of the river. And I think everybody, you know, at that meeting agreed that was really the goal.
It was a very productive night, and mm-hmm. I think we've established some understanding.
I also like to say Andrea Conover, who was responsible for doing all the groundwork and putting that whole trip together for the Riverkeeper and, you know, organizing that whole thing. It was a huge undertaking. She just bought a house here on the river, not far from Gay and Kevin. She loves it here. She's been doing all the paddle groups and the paddle trips with the Putnam Blue Ways groups, and she really loves the area. So she is moving here, And so I'm glad about that because she's very involved in many issues regarding the river. Let's see. So on that note, you know, we just completed the drawdown, and those of us who support, you know, restoration, a lot of us were out there. A lot of people that went there that don't normally go out to the Ocklawaha when the water's up, and the eco tour operators, myself included, we were swamped. We couldn't actually get everybody out there that wanted to go. Part of the reason was there was a big rain event to the south, and they opened the Moss Bluff locks from like 30 cubic feet per second to 2,500 cubic feet per second in about 2 days. So this big, as Greenway's manager called it, hump of water came through and browned out the springs that people came here from all over the state to see. So then they, you know, tried to come back later. So we had a couple of weeks in the middle there that wasn't actually drawdown conditions. Anyway, I wanted to give you an invitation representing all your constituents with 72,000 people. I think Commissioner Harvey, I've seen him quote that number. There are those of us, as you know, that would like to see a restoration. A lot of them are bank fishers. They don't have boats. There's a huge area where people can go out and go fishing. Am I up already? Wow, that was fast.
You're good.
Okay. Anyway, I just want to let you know Margaret Tolbert, who's an internationally renowned artist, is making a film about the springs and the people that go out there. And her experience, she actually does, during the last drawdown, she did a big series of paintings, and she sold them internationally. She's doing a film with Matt Keene and Mark Long, who's a cave diver. He's been in a lot of the films you might see about the aquifer. He's been featured in National Geographic, things like that. So he's going to be there. We're going to do, they're going to have a special presentation, and then we're asking people that came out to bring their pictures and share their experiences. It's just a positive, it's a look at the positives. So I wanted to let you know about that. Anybody's welcome to come. It's at Beef O'Brady's April 30th. And I don't expect to convince some people. I just want to let you know what Marion and Putnam counties are missing when the water's up and what's available when the water's down. And that's what this is all about. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Karen.
Sam, if you can make your way to the podium, Sam Carr.
And my email's on the back.
Thank you, Karen.
Do you have any questions?
Thank you.
Okay, I got a different hat on. I'm here to talk about Putnam County Earth Day celebration, which is going to be April 22nd through 23rd at Duns Creek State Park. And I'd like to read for you a prayer that was spoken here in Putnam County in April of 1774. It says, O Sovereign Lord, since it has pleased me to endue man with power and preeminence here on earth and establish his dominion over all creatures, may we look upon thee that our understanding may be so illuminated with wisdom and our hearts warm and animated with a due sense of charity that we may be enabled to do thy will and perform our duties towards those submitted to our service and protection and be merciful to them even as we hope for mercy. So, quite a prayer, saying, God, give us the will and the way to take care of what we got. That's what he was saying. And that was William Bartram in April of 1774, standing on top of Mount Royal in down in Georgetown. Amazing. That was his prayer. That's his heart. And I hate to say it, but I've adopted his heart. but that really means something to me. So the Putnam County Earth Day celebration is just that. It is a group of nature-based groups. There are 17 of us going to be gathering down there. We'll have live music, pony rides, kids' activities, recycling demonstrations, archaeological demonstrations, food vendors, birding hikes, all kind of nature tours and stuff like that. And we expect probably 500 people to show up at this thing. I don't know where we'll put them, but that's what we're going to do. We're going to have camping, equestrians are welcome. And all that. Duns Creek State Park is open now every single day. You can go down and go ride all the way down to Duns Creek. It's paved and all of that. And so this is our first event since the opening of it. And I gave everybody a flyer. So please come out and visit your constituents
at the Friends of Dunn's Creek State Park Putnam County Earth Day Celebration.
Share that date with us one more time.
April 23rd is the day. Okay. You can camp on the 22nd or 23rd if you'd like.
Is there a charge for that?
$10 fee for that. And there's a regular park admission fees, which is $5 a car. So, you know, that's what the state park charges.
Where do we get that flyer at, Mr.?
I handed them.
Oh, you, okay.
Yeah. We'll get them in just a moment.
But sure like to have y'all out there and visiting and everything. So this is our first try at this, and the Florida Park Service is really excited about it, and so are we. You know, we usually have different kind of events out there, but this is, we figured since it was one day after Earth Day that this would be appropriate. So we're going to try to make this an annual event for Putnam County down at Dunn's Creek State Park. Okay.
Again, we thank you for your tireless effort.
No problem.
All right, Sam. Okay, Janet Smith is our next speaker.
Janet Smith, 60 Carefree Drive in Willacka. We've heard from the Putnam Blue Ways and Trails people about what they did. Now, I would like to give them kudos on behalf of participants, because both my husband and myself did ride in those events, and they knocked it out of the ballpark. It was absolutely amazing, the support and the willingness of them to support not only the citizens of our county, but also the visitors in our county. Now, having said that, I think there is something that you do need to know about as commissioners. The animal control is part of your guys' responsibility, correct? This is an incident that you need to know about, because this is the sort of thing that kind of can pour some cold water on some good efforts on behalf of those that promote the trails and welcome visitors into our area. This was written on March the 31st, and it was on the Putnam Blue Ways and Trails Facebook. Continuing dog problem near Roberts Lane on the trail. Ron Robbins from Hastings was following behind David Waters, who arrived back to Roberts Landing before him yesterday. As Ron approached Roberts Lane, a Rhymerainer, according to David, came out from nowhere and collided with his front tire and swept the bike from underneath him. David took Ron to the Palatka Hospital and then was transferred to Orange Park. He suffered a broken scapula, broken second rib, a punctured lung with multiple scrapes. If you know where this dog is coming from, it needs to be dealt with ASAP. Obviously, this was a very serious injury and very unfortunate. I did call animal control to see what had been done. I was curious to know, and apparently they did talk to the owners, and the dog, they did say they would keep the dog contained. I called this morning, and I talked with Donna, who was very helpful and promised to get back with me with more information about what is the actual address of that, so that we can be looking for those sorts of things, those of us who ride bicycles. And she said she would get me the address and get back with me. To their credit, the animal control did go out on Saturday when, you know, we had all the bicyclists in town, and they did send a runner down the trail running back and forth to see if they could get the dog to come out. I don't think that probably works, because I think it's the sound of the bicycle that attracts the dogs. But the point is that it's so important that we do have good animal control, because this is a very dangerous situation for those that are riding the trails. So I wanted to be you guys to be aware of it, since that is one of your responsibilities, because we really don't want this to happen. It could certainly pour cold water on visitors to our community. So thank you.
Thank you. Okay, that was the end of our blue cards. Anybody from the public wishing to participate in public comment, now is the time. Please limit your comments to 3 minutes or less.
Not less. Good morning. Good morning. John Spells, 106 Citrus Lane. I see y'all have started on Hunter Road, but I got a question on Y'all installing culverts on Hunter Road, but on Cemetery Road, there's a smaller culvert, and with y'all now starting, now if y'all do pave it, you're going to have quite a bit of water coming through there, and that same culvert that got washed out about 3 years ago will get washed out again because it ain't but about a 16-inch pipe when you got about a 32-inch pipe on the other side, in which about 400 foot away, all of that water got to go through that little pipe. And my next thing is, y'all, how far are y'all going to actually pave that road down to Queens?
That's a public works question, John.
Okay, well, from my understanding, y'all only going to pave it partially away, but then you're going to leave a dirt road in between that and farther down the road. And to me, it really don't make sense because it's the same thing happened with Milligan Road. Y'all put millings on just about all of that road and then left a dirt strip, then went at the beginning on Palmetto Bluff and started putting milling down. Now you got a dirt strip, so when the grader come out, now he got to go in between both of them. So if, you know, if you're going to do it all the way instead of half doing it, because you're still going to have to send a grader out there in between and grade that area where the road is still dirt.
Okay, help me out. You mean Milligan?
Huh?
You need Milligan Road?
No, I'm talking about Hunter Road. Because the Lake Estates have a paved road go. All right, if you get right there to Queens that road come by Queens and go back out to 20, you just got a dirt strip in there, and you got people actually live on there. So if you're going to do it, you might as well go all the way down and don't have to send a grader out there.
Okay, Public Works is taking notes.
Okay, my next question, have y'all come to a conclusion on what y'all going to try to do with Rodman?
Retain it.
So y'all going to try to keep it?
As of right now, yes.
Okay, all right then. Okay, that's enough.
Okay. All right, anybody else from the public at this time? Seeing none, we'll move to the consent agenda. Commissioners, on the consent agenda, are there any items? I'm going to have Public Works Director Mike Nimitz come up and take I through M, any of the Public Works things to speak on. But A through H, is there anything?
On item F, I had just some questions, a little clarity there is all.
You want to pull it?
Please.
Or you just want to talk about
please.
It? Okay.
Well,
F,
just some clarity.
Commissioners, anything else?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to talk about item N, please.
Okay. N. We'll pull N and F. Let's go ahead and entertain a motion on A through E, G and H, and O.
Mr. Chairman, you may have to give me all those things, but anyhow, I'd like to move that we approve the consent agenda with the exceptions of item F, N, O, I heard, and I think.
O is not in there, but I through M is.
I through M.
Mm-hmm. Second.
We have a second. Any further discussion? Call a question. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, like sign, it carries. Okay. Walton, why don't you take F first?
Just some clarity is all. I'm just, I don't know who would bring forward that clarity on that, exactly what that means. And
I think Mr. Hammonds, thank you, sir.
Thank you. Good morning, Commissioners. Item F is a resolution, it's our first step toward trying to get into the community rating system. As I'm sure you remember, of course, the county participates in the National Flood Insurance Program that allows the county to be eligible for federally subsidized flood insurance for those properties that lie within mapped flood zones. We, of course, have to administer and enforce the state and federal codes involving that. Well, if you have a mortgage in a map flood zone, you are required by your lender and to have federal flood insurance. It has been that way since the inception of the program in the 60s. I think the county entered into the program about 85, if I'm not mistaken. What this is about is that the state and federal government have a program. It's called the Community Rating System, that if counties or jurisdictions, I should say, not only meet the requirements of our requirements of administering and building codes and that sort of thing and enforcing those rules. Well, if you wish to participate in the CRS and can go a little further than the basic requirements, you can amass points and get discounts for the public who has to have flood insurance or elects to have flood insurance. So we're trying to get the county into that program, trying to get enough points that we can achieve a rating. The ratings are from 1 to 9, 1 being the best. Matter of fact, there's only one community in the state that even ranks a 3, and that's the city of Ocala. We're just trying to get into the program at this point, and then we'll see where we can go from there. But even if we can achieve a rating of 9, that would give a 5% discount to those folks who have to have flood insurance.
Yeah.
And currently, or at last count, there's something on the order of between 1,300 and 1,400 policies in this county. And for anybody who has to have it, that's a help. The higher you rank, or the more points you can amass,
so what
you can get a greater discount.
So what do we do to increase our ranking?
This is the first step. We're just saying we will do these 7 measures that they look for, most of which we are already doing. As a matter of fact, I think all but maybe 1 are we actually doing at this point in our over the years. We're just saying that we will do this, and then moving forward, we'll try to amass points where we can through the program and try to better our rating. Right now, we're just trying to get in the program.
Okay. Brian, in your opinion, we operated there for a while kind of under 2 systems, one that was very old, not upgraded for 100 years, is that correct? And just recently, the National Flood Plain assessments.
No, the maps recently changed, but we've had maps since the inception, or since the county got into the program in the mid-80s. I think we're on our second or third map at this point. We most recently adopted it in early 2011 or 12.
Right, well, time flies. Adopted right. Maps. It's been that long. So is it safe to say that any of the folks like retailers of mobile homes and contractors building homes are aware, or really people selling property, that's better. Are they aware, Commissioner Harris, of these new maps, or recent maps, I should say? They're not new anymore.
They should be. I mean, that we just went from one set of maps to another. We widely publicized it. It was available for public comment, et cetera, for over 6 months.
Is it still the due diligence on the buyer to do their due diligence, or is there a vehicle or something when purchasing property that can send us
hope,
clarification?
I would hope that people know enough to do their due diligence. Certainly the real estate community usually does. And then if you're getting an institutional mortgage, the lender's going to catch it.
That's what I'm
and require
it. Commissioner Harris?
At the point that we sell vacant land, we have an attachment that we add to our contract, which tells them to go to the building department and to check everything out, that a lot of these things will affect you. I don't know if other companies do, but we do attach that. We want them to know and to check everything out. And then we try to check things out before we sell it, but we want them to be aware. So that's before they sign the contract, that they read that, that they know what to do. But there should always be more knowledge and to encourage people to check things out.
It's been a point of contention many times.
Yeah.
We urge everybody to do their due diligence. Come see us. That's part of what is required of these seven measures is that we keep track of the requests for information, the information we give out, we actually keep track of it.
Commissioner Pelser, you satisfied?
Pretty well. Just a couple small things. How often do they give you these ratings?
They re-rate. They check you and re-rate you yearly.
Yearly, okay.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Flagg.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. Go right ahead. Flagg and then Harvey.
I'm getting ready to make a motion.
Okay. Mr. Harvey.
I just, yeah, thank you, Mr. Flagg. Mr. Chairman, thank you, Mr. Hammonds, for this. This is kind of like the ISO of insurance rates. So when we're getting in the door here, we're going to start seeing discounts. And this is good. I remember those old flood maps from selling flood insurance back years and years ago, 25 years ago, and trying to find out where the property was at. Just for the audience, flood is outside rising water. It's not a broken pipe in your house. It's outside rising water. And it's very important to know the flood zones you're in. Also, from my years of selling insurance, elevation certificates are very, very important. They do cost a little bit of money from a surveyor to say how high you are up on the property versus where your floodplain is, but it will save you thousands of dollars, hundreds of thousands, sometimes hundreds, not thousands, but hundreds of dollars to do that, to do your due diligence in that arena. So it's very important. One last thing I want to say. Some people get confused, and lenders do too, and they go, well, just get flood insurance. Flood insurance has a limit that's built in. You can buy excess flood insurance if you need it. So if you're in a home that lives on the river and you're prone to flood, you can buy more insurance if you're needed from the excess market. So thank you, Mr. Chairman, for that ability to explain.
Mr. Flagg.
I would like to move adoption of this resolution with one small correction in the caption, the word resiliency. Probably an A need to be changed to an E, just Scrivener's error on that, but I so move the adoption of the resolution.
We have a motion on the floor and a second, I think I heard. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, like sign. Carries. Thank you, Commissioner Flagg.
And anyone in the public who desires information about flood maps, flood requirements, please come see us, planning and zoning.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Hammonds, for your commentary. All right. Let's take in. It was pulled by who?
Me, sir.
Okay. Commissioner Harvey.
Chief Romay, could I have you come up? At As he's coming up, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to say a big thank you to Chief Romay for thinking outside the box and piggybacking on this with Lake County. We could have done this on our own, but we didn't know the parameters, whether that would be higher, lower, or the same. I'd like to give you a chance to explain what this is, and then I'll close it up if you don't mind.
Basically what the request is we do a lot of purchasing, fire equipment, hose, nozzles, gloves, things that we use on a day-to-day basis. And in our efforts trying to obviously get the best bang for the buck and the cheapest price, Lake County has been one of our go-tos of late, and they have this contract in place that they've competitively bid out, and we are wishing to piggyback off of that. Some of the pricing in there is 40-45% off of list price. So utilizing, you know, a much larger county's bid, and they have several other agencies that are using it, also helps us to get the best bang for the buck.
I just wanted to say thank you very much for thinking outside the box and saving the citizens of Putnam County money. Yeah. So thank you.
And also, Chief, I guess it's fair to say that your staff can spend their time elsewhere working on more challenges instead of duplicating what's already been done, because fire departments buy the same materials throughout the 67 counties in the state of Florida.
That's correct. The standards are there that we all have to meet, and the color may change a little bit from one to the other, but, you know, we try to get the best quality at the cheapest price.
Okay, very well done.
So move authorization of this contract.
Motion on the floor. Second. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, like signs. Thank you, Chief Romay.
Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Nimitz, if we can take I through M, sir, and take them one at a time. How well we've been
doing that. Mike Nimitz, Interim Public Works Director. I brought up Paul Ina here to cover this first item with me if you guys have any additional questions.
Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Agenda item I, the Public Works Department requests the board's approval on the engineering services agreement with Stone Engineering for the reconstruction of Fort Gates Ferry Road from Highway 19 to Mount Royal Avenue in the amount of $549,375. Based on board approval of the shortlist, successful negotiations were conducted with Stone Engineering for the design, permitting, and bidding support services for the reconstruction of Fort Gates Ferry Road. The funding for this project is provided by FDOT, Small County Outreach Program.
So move.
Yes, sir.
A motion on the floor. Further discussion. I have a question. Any other commissioners?
I do.
Okay. Commissioner Harvey, you can lead it off.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you for all your hard work on this. Do we have any incentives built into this contract to speed up, to make sure that the Stone Engineering moves forward at a timely manner?
As far as it utilizing additional funds to,
no,
to accelerate the schedule? Or
incentives to maybe get them to get the job done faster. In some areas we've seen where other companies have kind of slowed down. Well, they had a year, they could do it in six, they're ahead of schedule, but they still got a year.
We're going to have to request an extension from FDOT, so okay. We will have basically a revised schedule that they're going to require of us, and we've discussed this with Stone Engineering. They're willing to compress their schedule as much as possible. Their project will be, their scope of the project, the design and the environmental studies will be running concurrently. We'll have to wrap both of those up at the same time. They will not let us proceed with construction until both those items are done. Okay. So we'll hit that milestone, and then we'll move forward with the bidding process and construction process. So Paul would like to add something.
Commissioner Harvey, I wanted to tell you from Stone Engineering that we don't need an incentive. Putnam County is one of our best clients, so we'll take care of the Thank county.
Yeah, and my question was the Federal Department of Forestry in this area are being cooperative. It was more inquisitive. In your opinion, Mr. Nimitz?
Yes, sir. There are requirements that they wanted to define within the NEPA study that needed to be done. Originally, the scope of work included a bike trail that required disturbing, existing forestry grounds and things of that nature. We reduced it down to just basically blacktop over existing roadway.
In the smallest impervious area possible. Is
yes,
that
sir.
Correct?
Least impact. And so that really made things move forward. And we've sat down, we've had numerous meetings with them, they've defined what they want from us, and we're ready to move forward with this finally.
Okay. Paul, what I would like to see, if I could, Commissioner Flagg, just finish my statement, is just cooperation with Putnam County Environmental Council, Federal Department of Forestry, or anybody involved, a compromise. I do understand what they're wishes are, and we understand what our constituents' wishes are, and good luck, sir. That's all.
I want to reinforce, we did take out the trail, and we are just going to do blacktop in the smallest swale, the smallest footprint as possible to have the least environmental impacts. Yeah. And we have a good environmental crew that's going to make sure the National Forest Service gets what they want as far as an environmental and cultural resources. We've all have that ready to go.
Very well. Okay. Question's been called. Motion on the floor. Do I get a second?
Second.
Okay, got it. All right. Any further discussion? Well, no, it can't be. All in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Like sign. Thank you. Appreciate you being with us, Paul.
The next item on the agenda, item J. The Public Works Department requests the board's approval and awarding for the W. Lewis Brower Road Extension Project, including the St. John's Avenue Moody Road intersection pavement striping to the lowest responsible bidder, which was Best Smith, in the amount of $144,166.99. We have done a pre-award meeting with Best Smith, gone through the entire scope of work of what's expected of them, sequencing and things of that nature will be more defined as we get further in the process. But we feel they are a competent contractor, their subs are competent, and They were the low bidder, so we would like to recommend them.
Motion on the floor?
Second.
We've got a second, and I just want to congratulate you on the design of the extension of Lewis Brewer Road. I think it's very nice looking.
Yes.
If you haven't been out there, it's really good.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. No further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, like sign, it carries. Thank you, Mr. Nimitz.
The next item on the agenda here, agenda item K, the Public Works Department requests the board's approval for addendum number 3 to Mid Tower and Associates Continuing Services Agreement for engineering services on the St. Johns River Estates Paving and Drainage Improvements Project in the amount of $6,050. During the design process, an undersized inlet and outfall were discovered, necessitating additional survey work that was outside the original scope of the agreement.
Got a motion on the floor?
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Thank you, Mr. Nimitz.
The next item here would be L.
Mr. Spells left early, didn't he?
Yes. Yes, he did.
This would be change order number 1 to the current 2015 dirt to pave contract with North Florida Emulsions. The Public Works Department requests the board's approval to extend Hunter Road from the current contract limit for an additional 0.2 miles. The added road usage and savings and mobilization fees justifies this extra expenditure of this fund. This additional roadway would service 5 additional houses. And if you look at the attachment in the agenda, you can see from the map or just extend.
Second.
Motion on the floor?
I have a question.
Okay. Second. And question?
Okay. Yep. Does this cover the additional area that Mr. Spells was talking about?
There is an additional area of Hunter Road, looking at it from the map of it to the west, that was not included on this dirt to pave.
Yes.
That I would have to look at. But I believe that maybe the area he was referring to. I'd have to follow
this
up.
This is not in reference to what he was referring to?
I do not believe so.
Okay.
This was to actually the loop between Hollister Church Road and Durden Road, but then the extension takes it down to what is the Hollister School Road.
Hollister School Road, that's correct.
Where Chester intersects, so it makes all of that whole. I think the other issue that Mr. Spell was raising, if you look where the Hollister Cemetery Road is, obviously while we're doing the pavement, whatever excess water, I think he was talking about the drainage and the condition of a culvert that was off Hollister Cemetery Road, which is midway between, well not midway, but between where the original church road and before you get there. Well, I guess it is about midway there. But I'm sure you all are looking at the drainage while you're doing the overall project and making sure that engineering wise that it's done.
Again, taking advantage of the mobilization of all this equipment, this was a very good move on your department, Mr.
Absolutely.
Nimitz. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, I brought that forward, that extension, because it only made sense that it was 0.2 miles to close that loop of the Hollister School Church Road, or Hollister School Road, because it's paved already going back toward the Highway 20 and looping back into the Hollister Church Road. It would just,
perfect.
It would be crazy not to.
That's right.
To okay, close
question,
that up.
The question has been called. Commissioner Bellis here in a second. So all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, like sign, it carries. Thank you.
The next item on the agenda would be change order number 2 for North Florida Emulsions. The Public Works Department requests the board's approval to add Harbor Farms Drive and Harbor Farms Court to the dirt to pave contract. The contractor is currently working in the area. Adding Harbor Farms Drive and Harbor Farms Court will save $7,000 in mobilization. And there's also an existing $3,000 worth of lime rock that's part of an MSBU for the area that could be utilized at the same time. And this area services 20 plus houses.
It does. And it's in very good shape right now.
Second.
For payment. Have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, like sign. Thank you, Mr. Nimitz.
Thank you all.
I believe you were done, sir. Okay, did we get them all, Commissioners?
Yeah, we did. Thank you.
We have. Okay, we're going to move to code enforcement. Mr. John Sammons is with us this morning. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Excuse me. The first case is 2013-0401, 105 Caribbean in Interlaken. Maria Rivera owns the property. She's asking for a fine reduction request. Staff received a complaint regarding unpermitted activity at the property. A courtesy notice was sent out indicating that permits were required for the type of work that was being done. Staff went out and inspected the property on July 26, 2013 and found unsafe electrical and much work being done without permits. A notice of unsafe building was sent out on the same day. No permits had been obtained by August 19, 2013. Staff continued to monitor the situation. The notice of unsafe building was recorded on October 8, 2013. Nothing was still happening. A notice of violation and hearing was sent out on December 5, 2013. The case went before the special magistrate on March 20, 2014, and he found the property to be in violation and gave the owner until June 1, 2014 to bring the property into compliance or a $25 day fine would commence. Nothing happened. The case went back before the special magistrate on August 21st, 2014, and he found the property still be in violation and imposed an order to record the lien. A demolition permit was finally issued on the property on April 1st, 2015. The demolition was not happening. A letter stating that the permit would expire if activity wasn't seen soon was sent out. Ms. Rivera did get the the demolition permit was final on February 9th, 2016, and she requested a fine reduction hearing. Special magistrate heard her request for a fine reduction on March 17th, 2016, and he recommended that the $15,400 fine be reduced to $747 if it's paid within 60 days of board action, which would be June 11th.
Mr. Sammons, Mr. Rivera with us this morning?
Ms. Rivera, yep.
They are? The applicants here?
I haven't seen them. Okay. They were sent a notice to be here, but I think she has some health problems, so she evidently didn't come.
Okay, but it's final.
Yep.
Demolition was. All right, Commissioner.
So move.
All right.
Second.
Move approval. Second.
Question.
All right. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Members like sign. Thank you, Mr. Sammons.
Next case is two cases, 2009-01198 and 2014-0219. Paul Arledge, 105 Taboo Melrose. This is a fine reduction request also. Mr. Arledge is elderly and in not very good shape also, so I don't think he's here. The property was first inspected on February 4th, 2010. There was an unsafe mobile home on the property with a roof caving in. Staff posted the property as unsafe and sent out a notice of violation hearing on February 5th, 2010. The case went before the special magistrate on April 15th, 2010, and he found the property to be in violation and gave the owner until June 14th, 2010 to bring the property into compliance or a $25 day fine would commence. Property was inspected on June 14th and the mobile home had been demolished, but all the trash and debris was still there. They didn't move anything off the property. Accessory structure is also still in violation. Property continued to deteriorate over the next month. A new case was opened on the property for someone camping on the property who happened to actually be Mr. Arledge's son. On January 26, 2015, Code Enforcement and the Fish and Game did a joint inspection and gave the owners 60 days to clean up the property. The owners began cleaning up the property. It was not done within the scheduled time, so a hearing before the special magistrate on April 16, 2015, he found the property to be in violation and gave the owners until May 31st, 2015 to bring the property into compliance. The property continued to be in violation throughout 2015 and the first part of 2016. The property was found to finally be in compliance on January 21st, 2016. The owner requested a fine reduction hearing. Special magistrate heard the request on March 17, 2016, recommended that the board accept $1,000 in lieu of the $51,500 fine if it's paid within 90 days, which is July 11, 2016. Any questions?
Okay. The applicant, I don't believe, is here.
So move.
Okay, motion on floor.
Second.
Further discussion, hearing none.
We have some, Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
This took 6 years to happen, you know? And it seems like they just, I mean, just, we don't care about your ordinance. We don't care about Putnam County. And did what they wanted to do on this property. And I think that's why we get a black eye in this county. Is somehow, I don't know if we can tighten them up a little bit faster, but this shouldn't have not taken place like that.
Yep. It's a situation we run into often. This gentleman was very elderly. He couldn't handle the situation. Finally, his siblings got involved, and ultimately they came and took care of the problem.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
This was, okay, we have motion and second on floor. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, like sign, thank you.
The next case we actually heard a couple of months ago, and unless you want me to, I won't go through the litany. Basically, what happened there was Ernest Clayton, one of the owners of the property, indicated that he was at the special magistrate's hearing and wasn't afforded the opportunity to talk. Between that meeting and now, Stacy Manning, our county attorney, has listened to the tape, and he can tell you what he heard. And Ernest is here also.
He is.
Mr. Chairman, I did listen to the tape from that hearing, and there were extensive discussions in that matter, and Mr. Clayton was given the opportunity to present his position. He was not defending the property. He was agreeing that the county could do what was being done. So he did, and he actually was advised also by the magistrate that if he brought the property into compliance, that he could request the fine reduction, and he was advised to discuss that with staff, which apparently that was the follow-up that occurred that brought this matter before you all.
Okay, so you're satisfied with this, and Mr. Clayton, you're here with us, you said?
Ernest has a bad back.
Yeah, I remember this one.
Good morning to everybody.
Good morning. Morning. Good morning, Mr. Clayton.
Ernest Clayton, 299 Mile Road.
Thank you, John.
Georgia. I didn't hear him make a statement saying that he said he didn't want to hear anything that I had to say.
No, sir, I don't believe he said that.
He said that?
No, sir. No, Mr. Manning, Mr. Clayton saying that you didn't want to hear anything he had to say. I don't think that's the case.
No, that's not.
No,
I just indicated that there was an opportunity to be heard before the special magistrate.
Okay.
Yes, sir. That's all, Mr. Clayton.
Good.
Any questions of us, Mr. Clayton? You agree with the terms here you got with the special magistrate?
No, like I made a statement before. You know, with my livelihood, I was deprived of that. And I felt like, you know, if he would have listened to me, then he would have given me time to go ahead on and get the house back in order. You know, that's the way I felt, you know. So far, you know, since my sister started, because it was three times that he had her to appeal, and she didn't appear but one time, but then my brother kept coming down to see what was going on. So I done been here six times from Atlanta, which I do own property here, so from Tittle, part of Putnam County, okay? So I added up, I done been 4,800 miles, this is my sixth time, and I done spent over $900 just in gas coming here to make sure that things are done decent in order. And like I was saying, I don't feel like it's fair, because I came and I spent 7 weeks to tear down the trailer and get everything right. And I done lost as it is, so I don't think it's fair for me and my brother to be paying a fine.
So, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Question.
For Mr. Fry.
So, Mr. Clayton, you are disagreeing with the magistrate's recommendation, is what you're saying?
Yes, yes.
So the only thing that's going to satisfy you is a zero?
Zero sound like the right?
No, I'm saying that's, I'm asking you that
yes,
question.
Yes, yes, okay. Yes, yes.
Okay, so I just wanted to know that, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. So, yes. Commissioner Harris?
I'm not sure I understood you, what you had to say, Mr. Clayton. The last time you were here, you said that the special magistrate did not allow you to speak.
He said he didn't want to hear anything I had to say.
Okay. So our attorney got the tape of that meeting and listened to it, and he said that you got to talk quite a bit.
No,
on
I
the
didn't
tape.
Either. Okay, then if I got to talk, repeat what I said, then, and then I'd be satisfied.
Say that again, please.
I said then if he said that I had a right a chance to speak, then come back to me and explain everything that I said when I came before the magistrate and what he said.
Do you recall the things that were said?
Well, it was a lengthy hearing. We could certainly get a transcript of it if that's what you all wanted to do.
Was his brother, Mr. Clayton, were the voices confused as to which one of the Clayton brothers were speaking? Did your brother speak also?
No, I was the one who spoke.
You did all the speaking?
I the one who spoke.
Okay, so why do you think you were not allowed to speak if you did all the speaking?
Because I wasn't even up there for 30 seconds. It's no way that there is saying what I said or saying what the magistrate said. That's what I'm saying. It should have word for word, verbatim by verbatim, because I know that what was said to me. He said, if I got up there and I explained it to him what I was going to do, he said, I don't want to hear anything you got to say. That's what he said, and it should be on that tape.
According to my notes from what I listened to, Cornelius Clayton Jr. advised the case goes back to 2010, and the amount of the fine and abatement and foreclosure were sought. He indicated his sister didn't tell the family of the problems with the codes. He indicated that he was not defending the property. He indicated that he agreed that the county can do what the county has to do. The magistrate ordered abatement and foreclosure, gave him time to remove the mobile home and to save the property. And then he was advised if he brought the property into compliance, he can request a fine reduction, and advised to discuss that process with staff. I also got copies of a number of various notices that were sent out to Evangeline Clayton et al. At 441 State Road 26 in Melrose. Those were also copied with a copy to Ernest Clayton at 299 Millam Road in Fayetteville, Georgia, and Cornelius Clayton at P.O. Box 1042 Melrose, Florida. And I have quite a few of those notices. Copies as well as the certified mail indicating that those were delivered.
Commissioner Flagg.
Mr. Chairman, can we request Mr. Cornelius Clayton to join his brother here and the line that says Cornelius Clayton agreed with the order for the county to foreclose or abate at the hearing, so maybe he can add some information. Mr. Cornelius Clayton is in the audience.
Yes, we can bring him up. That would be great. For the history, now, wasn't this a mobile home that was near the Seventh-day Adventist camp? Am I on the right one? No, this is not.
No, this is not.
It's in Melrose. It's in Melrose, okay.
In Melrose, Florida.
Okay, different. I wanted to make sure. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
If you would state your name and address for the record, it would be helpful.
Cornelius Clayton, 126 Power Line Trail. That mobile home you were talking about, I think I was here last time. That was over in Johnson near the Seventh-day Adventist camp. The mobile home that we taken down was the one in Melrose on Highway 26.
Okay.
And I may state something else. My sister had been in the nursing home for years, and I just happened to go by where the mailbox is, and they're still putting mail in there, and I went and told the post office. So I'm just clarifying something. So if any mail goes to Evangeline at 447, whatever it is, I'm gonna take that box down because it's not gonna be a mail outlet. And if she got some, if the mail carrier put it in there, I'm pretty sure when she came back and to put some more mail in, she probably taken it out because I took out what was in there and told them to delete that box. Now, what else you wanna ask me?
Yes, we got some questions, Mr. Clayton.
Yeah. The summary highlight indicates that Mr. Cornelius Clayton agreed with the order for the county to foreclose or abate at the hearing. And do you agree with that statement? Is that a statement of fact?
Okay, I gotta try to recall what
Did you speak at all at the hearing?
Yeah, at that particular hearing, I did speak.
Okay, and it was pretty
not the last one.
Okay, but when you were in that meeting, and apparently this was again in 2014, so I know it may be because it's been 2 years ago, but the county hand was forced, and it was necessary to either foreclose or abate, and I don't know whether both brothers were in the meeting. And while we're being sympathetic to the details and sensitive to your sister's health decline, once we got to this point, it was kind of out of hand. But then when you look at the fine had accrued up to $50,675, but then the magistrate apparently was listening when the reduction was down to $1,362. And so I guess when you look at the amount of time that was also involved, we are sensitive to the health decline, but at the end of the day, it's still a family affair, and everybody that is connected family-wise certainly have to be aware in one way, shape, form, or fashion. And so going through the various changes that you've gone through, zero is not on the table. What's on the table is the $1,362 in lieu of the $50,675. And so at this point, I know that this commission is very sensitive to each case on a case-by-case basis, but when you look at the cost that the county has invested there, that's pretty much what's being recommended, that the total cost of enforcement and the time lapse is what caused it to be at cost. This is not punitive. This is actually recouping the cost.
Well, can I say this? I'm not here in disagreement of the outcome, okay? Mm-hmm. I didn't even intend to be up here speaking. I was not in agreement with what was made, the statement that was made. Okay.
All right, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Clayton.
Thank you. So move we accept the recommendation of the special magistrate.
Excuse me, sir. I'd like to finish.
Excuse me, sir. I have a motion on the floor. Okay. We have to finish our business before we can do that. Okay, we have a motion.
Second.
We do have a second. Any further discussion?
Well, if you want him to speak.
Yes. This is the time, sir.
Yes. I'm still saying that what the attorney came back with from what was said is not factual. It's not factual because I know he told me he didn't want to hear anything I had to say. So which meant that if he didn't want to hear anything I had to say, then what could I do but go back to Atlanta, okay? My thing with this here, you all came in here, y'all give us 90 days to tear the house, to get the house in order. And I went on and did. I came here for 7 weeks and I did what y'all had asked me, okay? To me, I feel like, you know, I lost in this situation because I had to tear it down at the time when I was talking to the magistrate, the house could have been rehabbed. That's just where I feel.
Mr. Flagg said it just a second ago, but the taxpayers have a cost here because of a family affair that wasn't properly looked after. We've gone from $50,675 to $1,362. I know you feel like you're shortchanged on this, but we have to look out for the taxpayers' interest too. And what we're recouping here is the actual cost that it cost us, just like you gave your extra cost a moment ago, for staff to go out for your family affair. And we put everything on the table that we could to help you. And I hope you understand that, sir.
Okay, let me say this. I'm a taxpayer in Putnam County,
too. Yes, sir, you are.
Okay, and I should have the same right. But now, if I'm not mistaken, when I was here the last time, Commissioner Flagg said that me and my brother's name was on the deed, and we are responsible because our name is on the deed. Am I right?
That's right.
Okay, then I feel like this. I'm not saying that my name was on the deed, okay? My name was on the deed. My brother's name was on the deed, my sister's name was on the deed, and my mother's name on the deed. Now that's four of us on that deed. So we all supposed to be responsible in that case then, because you can't tie me and my brother to pay the whole thing when four of us was involved on that deed.
I'm gonna go to Mr. Harvey, hold it right there. You had a comment, and then to Mr. Manning, if you could give us some clarification on his last statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I concur with you and Commissioner Flagg's comments. Mr. Clayton, I find you to be a very reasonable man, but the county is just trying to recoup the $1,362 in hard cost. The magistrate was listening. He reduced your fine down from a $49,313 reduction. Undoubtedly, he listened to you, and we just need to recoup our cost. And you've got four people on the thing. I would recommend that you go out and get a check from everybody to pay this thing
off.
Well,
see, now, excuse me, sir, you telling me to go out?
Somebody go out. I don't
care. Well, we'll get a legal interpretation from Mr. Manning. Hold it right there, Mr. Clayton. Now, there are four names on that deed, sir.
The magistrate's order goes against all the named individuals, the owners of the property. So it's to all owners, and it's amongst themselves to decide how they're going to pay it.
All right, let me go out with a scenario. If these two brothers pay their portion, proportionally, this fine, then the responsibility for remaining balance goes to the other folks on the deed?
No, they're each responsible for all of it.
Yeah, okay. Everybody is 100% responsible.
By law?
Yes.
By law. That's Chairman, from the attorney. Yes.
Mr. Cornelius Clayton is on his way back.
Okay.
He may have something to add. The only thing that I was going to suggest is that it appears that we feel that the county must be made whole. And the only thing I was wanting to discuss is whether 120 days would help them versus the 90 days on it. But let's see what Mr. Cornelius have to say.
Let's do that, sir. Mr. Cornelius.
I would just like to say that my mother is deceased.
I'm sorry, sir.
And I don't know how many years, probably over 10 or 12 years. I just want y'all to know that that has nothing to do with the payment that y'all stipulating for us to pay. I just want to, she's the deceased, so her name can not be in this, all right?
It's not, sir. It's on the four siblings.
No, yeah. I'm not disagreeing with anything. I'm just letting you know, because you didn't know he's, so that's, okay.
Okay.
Mr.
Chair. Yes, Commissioner Harris.
I wanted to make sure, Mr. Clayton, you understood what Mr. Flagg was thinking, that would it help if we extended the time from the fine being due in 90 days to 120 days? Would that help you accumulate the money?
Well, it's not high and long as if we're going to take. I just feel like that it's not fair to me. You know, I mean, if it's 60 days or 90 days, I'm still going to have to pay it. But I just don't feel like it's fair. I really don't. Well, I really don't. I mean, I understand y'all looking out for the county, and I understand that. But it seems like nobody's looking out for my feeling or understanding in my situation, okay? Because I didn't start this. It was done by my sister, okay? And then after she didn't do her part, then I was stepping in. Me and my brother was stepping in. See what I'm saying? To go ahead on and do it, you know? To the house down or get it redone right.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Clayton, that might very well be the fact, but
yeah, we're not disputing your facts with your family. But if the shoe was on the other foot and another citizen was up here, then you would be bearing the cost of something that was among their family. And so we have to look at the balance as well as the counterbalance. And so are you saying that it doesn't matter whether it's 90 days or 120 days?
Well, it don't make a difference. Y'all gonna make me pay anyway, right?
We're not making you pay.
Yes, you. You're putting it in my situation where I have no choice, okay? No choice.
But if you feel you've been done wrongly by your sister, the courts are open to you, sir. You can. That's a whole nother matter that we are not responsible for deciding in this chamber.
My sister, ideally, that the magistrate summoned her for three times. Okay, I wasn't summoned. Okay, but I came in on the third time to explain to him what I was going to do, and I still say on that thing, it's not said what was said. It's not said. And I know that because I know what I said and I know what he said, and I wasn't up there for 30 seconds.
It doesn't change the facts.
That's okay.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, Mr. Clayton, this body did not order the fines. Those fines came in the process where this matter was heard before the special magistrate, and the special magistrate issued his order imposing those fines and creating the lien. What's here before this body today is a request by the property owners to reduce that fine, and the magistrate recommended that reduction be made to the amount that's before them today. So really the issue of whether there should be or should have been a fine in the first place really was an issue that should have been resolved before this today. The request today is for the reduction.
Yes, I understand that, you know, but the same token, I'm gonna say this and then I'm through. The gentleman up here before, his was $15,000, and y'all brought it down to 700. The magistrate brought it down to 700, and then y'all accepted it. But you all have the power to override what the magistrate says. Y'all have that power.
To reduce
it lower.
Each case has a fine reduction worksheet, and it consists of administrative research, inspections, certified mail sent out, recordings to hearing officers, administrative monthly, all of those itemized areas. So we are not randomly selecting the numbers here. All of this information on a fine reduction worksheet is presented to us. And again, as a result of what all happened over time, the cost per unit, all of these items were calculated based on actuality. So it was not a random number that was presented to us there. And there are other fees that could have applied, but because of the modesty and the accommodating administration, it was not even added in here.
Okay, I accept that, but the same token is that if my sister is still living, right, mm-hmm. then she should be part of this. Why should me and my brother recoup the whole responsibility?
No. We're not putting it on you and your brother. Your sister's still a part of this equation. However, when you have all of those names listed together, then this commission does not have the authority to even split it up in one-thirds. Everybody is responsible for 100%. How you all do it is truly a family affair. It's not a commission affair. It's a family affair.
Well, I would like
question.
The question's been called. That's it, Mr. Clayton. We can take no more commentary. So, all in favor of the special magistrate's recommendation, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, like sign. It carries, Mr. Clayton.
I still think it's unfair.
Okay, sir. We respect your opinion, and thank you. John, you've got one more, I think, here.
Actually, I think Brian's going to do the last one. So. I will refer to him.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Sammons.
The introduction.
Okay. I'll go through the first part of it. This is a partial release of lien for David Cox of BB Cox LLC. The lien was actually on a different property than Mr. Cox bought. It was owned by John Ross Kinney. And its parcel number was 08-1024-6782-0010-0300, which is on Yancey Circle. Code enforcement had the case against Mr. Kinney on Yancey Circle. We ended up abating the property and a fine lien were both recorded against Mr. Kinney. And the liens pursuant to Florida statutes also attached to other properties that Mr. Kinney owned. The parcel in question is another property that he owned at the time, and thus the lien was attached to it as well. The parcel went up for tax deed sale and was bought by a different entity, Tax Lien, Tax Ease LLC. The liens were recorded, and Tax LLC was surely afforded the opportunity to review the title search that the clerk of the court does on all tax deed sales. And so they were obviously aware of the tax lien when BB Cox LLC purchased the property from Tax Ease. They didn't afford him the information that there was a code enforcement lien on the property. Mr. Cox contacted staff concerning the property to see if there was any liens on it or code enforcement cases, and based upon the fact that Tax Ease was the property owner and didn't have the lien him on themselves, when we checked the property, we said there was no liens on the property. Mr. Cox ultimately ended up purchasing the property from Tax Ease. He has found an owner, somebody that wants to buy it. When the title search was done, the tax lien showed up on the property. Mr. Cox requested a partial release of the lien on the property in question. That went before the special magistrate on March 17, 2016. Mr. Cox spoke with the special magistrate. The lien is a valid lien according to the county attorney because of what we've mentioned before. Anyways, the special magistrate basically told Mr. Cox he should have done a title search when he bought the property. And he felt that was Mr. Cox's due diligence to do that. And I'll let Brian talk from here.
This is becoming a more and more frequent problem. We do have a lot of properties that sell at tax deed sales, and a tax deed sale will void most liens that are outstanding at the time of the sale. But any governmental lien, it will not void. And our liens, code enforcement liens or abatement liens, travel through with the property. In many cases, these particularly LLCs, these are businesses that are out there buying and selling this stuff right, left, and sideways. They buy this stuff and they sell it off quickly. They make a few bucks, they move on. They generally do not clean the property up. They typically do not go through the quiet title process or do anything to fix its problems. They just pass them on to somebody else, okay? But again, we see, from staff's perspective, we see these businesses, these dealers, differently than we do some local citizen that wants to put a mobile home on it, that's an individual. They're not as astute as these businesses that are dealing in these things should be. These LLCs should be doing their homework. They should be doing their due diligence. They don't always. As a matter of fact, in this case, the applicant, BB Cox LLC, again, purchased this from Tax Ease. Did not do their due diligence. They did not do a title search. And Tax Ease had bought it on a tax certificate. Currently, Tax Ease has at least three under their name that have abatement liens on them out there. And we're, again, watching those very carefully as they come through. And as you know, in the past, abatement liens are particularly sensitive to us because we actually had to lay out the cash to remove the problem. And, you know, we're not willing, staff, code enforcement, is not willing to just concede those. So you may see some more of these in the future, even though, in this case, BB Cox LLC is not, for lack of a better analogy, they caught a communicable disease by picking up a property without doing the proper care. They are responsible for this lien. Now, again, it is the board's lien. The board can do what it wants to with its liens. But staff is not willing to just concede them.
Okay. Commissioner Flagg?
Yes, sir. Mr. Hammonds, can you drill down on what you meant when you say the band right, left, and sideways? I'm teasing.
Excuse me?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we concur with the recommended action or with the order of the special magistrate. Whatever teachable moments need to be gained, they can learn.
I agree.
Second.
Got a motion and a second.
John's informing me that Mr. Cox may be in the audience.
Is that right?
Mr. Cox here?
Question.
He did show up at the magistrate's hearing, but apparently is not here.
Okay.
I do have a question, Mr. Chairman.
Well, the question's been called by Mr. Flagg, so we got to vote. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Stacy, do you want to clean this up?
Say that again.
Hold it. I have the floor. Thank you. The question was called by Commissioner Flagg. We will vote, and if you want to follow up with a question, that's fine. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, like sign. Thank you. All right. Commissioner Harvey.
We'll deal with another time.
Okay. Well, all I'm saying is if you call a question or anybody, I have to follow the rules. Okay, that was a good explanation. And, you know, we say we, as in planning and development or the commission, but they're taxpayer dollars. They have that invested in that property, and it's our due diligence to look out for those dollars.
Right. As in all cases, these liens are yours. They are not ours. They are yours.
That's right.
So ultimately, you dispose of them as you see fit.
Yeah. It's a tricky business, tax deed, when you're buying and selling.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I think that we ought to develop a policy so that when these come, we can refer to the policy. I don't know how important that'll be, but if we're going to have more and more of these coming, I would like for the department with the attorney to at least look at a policy that we look at so that we're not dealing with case by case. We can refer to the policy, we can apply the policy, and we can move these forward.
Mr. Manning, that's doable, isn't it?
It is. It is. You can have a policy that, you know, if, for example, if the board wanted to delegate authority to release in certain situations, you know, and you outline those in the policy, you could certainly
do that.
It would
be good. I know as the economy ticks back up for us and we get out of this recession that these type deals are more frequent. I remember it well. And we're going to see more and more. You're right, Commissioner Flagg. So, yeah, I think that would be very helpful.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Since I handle tax deed sales, one of the issues here is that generally the vast majority of the parcels that sell at a tax deed sale, the amount is probably in the $2,000 range. So what happens is exactly what Mr. Hammond says, is it's not advantageous for the owner to do any additional title work because, you know, a title policy could cost several hundred dollars. So they're just moving things along. So I think my point is that I think a policy is good because you're going to see more and more of these because these just get moved, and there's more likelihood than not that this property will come back again at some point in a tax deed sale. And so until we have a policy, know how for them to handle those requests without taking up your time, you're going to have more and more of those. And it really is a buyer beware prospect, particularly in tax deed sales. And we have a statement that we read at every meeting, and it talks about your responsibilities. The problem is when someone buys it at a tax deed sale and then they sell it and the new buyer has not heard any of this conversation and they don't know to contact the tax collector and see if there are any additional fines or fees
or to do a title search themselves, which they can online through our public records system, and see if there's anything on it. So I think a policy probably is a really good idea for this county to have as it relates to these issues. Thank you.
And if I could, Mr. Chairman, I think maybe a good idea would be to bring this up, Brian, if we had it in a workshop, we can kind of get some direction as far as, you know, what kind of policy or the direction that you want us to go in crafting that policy and what the will of the board is.
Let's do that.
In that direction.
Okay, Mr. Powell, you've been waiting since 10 o'clock. We're here, I'm certain.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
We have a proposed change to section 8-95 of the ordinance for reciprocity. After a lot of discussion amongst the contractor review board, they want to strike out some language in the section that allows the contractor licensing person to grant a 30-day period before the person reciprocates and comes to the board and to see if the board will accept them or accept their qualifications for licensure within the county. So the contractor review board is asking to strike that last section out of that paragraph. For a maximum 30-day period preceding their appearance before the board, the licensing administrator may issue such contractor a permitting and work authority letter. The contractor review board would like to see them before they start work within the county if they're reciprocating on a county level license from another county.
Okay, reading through it, I agree with the lack of protection we have under the current situation, but also am mindful of the reputation we get when we delay contractors' will to work, and also the consumer. You know, I don't want them to be cheated, but at the same time, I don't want that reputation like, well, I couldn't do any work in Putnam County for 30 days until I went in front of this this board of theirs. So
right.
How do we...
This is only for county registered contractors, not for state contractors. State contractors can come and do business as they wish here.
As I read it, though, it's for out of county.
Out of county that are registered, that are not state contractors.
Again, what I'm saying, for them to be registered,
right,
you could delay them 30 days. How do we compromise?
I think you're missing something there,
I
Mr.
am,
Chairman.
Tell me what I'm missing.
Maybe I'm missing it, but if they're a state certified contractor, that supersedes a county level contractor.
All right, so if I hire an Orange Park contractor to come in and build a porch on my house.
As long as they're state contractor, they can come here and do business as usual.
Without going in front of the contractor's
correct
board.
They do not have to. We do not regulate state contractors.
I stand correct.
This is only for county licensure, not for state licensure.
Okay, very well. Commissioner Harris, you had?
I was just gonna ask, why is it 30 days? Can it be shortened?
Well, they shorted it 30 days just then.
I
thought it was too good to be true.
The contractor review board feels that they should see them before they come in here and see if they have any disciplinary actions on them from other jurisdictions. However, our licensing administrator does that. The contractor review board just feels that they would like to go ahead and see them, meet them, and see what they're about before they grant them the licensure within Putnam County.
And they meet every 30 days?
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Chairman, the loophole need to be closed.
It does, but not at the cost of our reputation.
Well, again, if they are state certified, the door is open and the gatekeeper is giving them the pass card.
What's happened that's brought it to light with them is we'll put out contracts for the abatement, and somebody will just come in here on a county licensure, come here, do one job, and come in, do an abatement, leave, and then it goes before the board, and they're saying, okay, they can do work here, where they've already done the work.
I understood that part, and I agree with you, and it does give some protection to our local contractors.
Right.
So I do like that part of it. Any other comments from commissioners? Okay.
I think the opportunity is right just to mention that this board supports what I call one-stop shopping and the efficiencies and effectiveness with the best customer service that we can get there. If there is a citizen who's struggling with being in compliance, and they're you know, certainly we don't recommend them to anyone, but we give them the list of all that are registered in our county, I hope, and
we do. We have a list of registered and state certified contractors on our webpage that they can go to. Mm-hmm. However, like we stated earlier, if you're a state contractor, it's open for business here.
Yes, sir.
You can come in as a state contractor and do business. They don't get that many requests for reciprocation mm-hmm. in the county. We get a few a year, and the biggest one has been the folks doing abatement and coming from other counties doing the abatement work within Putnam County.
I think that from a public relations perspective, we need to have some signage up on with our staff and in the office saying that we are contractor friendly, we are citizen friendly, and it need to be a reminder to everyone in the department that that's what we're about. We're out of business without those people coming to us, and this loophole being closed is going to help us all be better. But at the end of the day, we must make sure that excellence and efficiency is how we do everything over there.
Yes, sir.
That being said, you finished, sir?
Yes, sir.
The credit card machines, how are we doing in
November?
What's that?
November. I don't know what year. We're actually now doing a test on a new system, and it is accepting credit cards. We've been sitting with IT the last few days, and we've tested the system, and it looks like we should be going online soon. We want to go ahead and get our permit staff familiar with the new program that we're implementing before we go into it.
That's a good idea.
We're developing a complete new program for the permitting, but this is kind of a fix with the old property appraiser screen. So we've been testing it, and it does accept credit cards. We just have to go ahead and get staff and get them used to doing it. They had to make a couple more changes to the screen from IT because we go through and make sure that things are working right. So there was just a couple of areas that they needed to adjust. We should be having another meeting hopefully this week on that. And then I'd like to spend a good week or better training staff on accepting credit cards.
Okay. Commissioner Flagg had something.
I just want to know what you mean when you say November, but you don't know what year.
We were told November from IT. This is a two-year
All right.
I know it
scenario.
He's picking at me. Mr. Manning.
I just wanted to remind that this is a public hearing, so before a vote is taken, if there are anybody in the audience that wish to discuss this matter.
Despite our detour, we're coming back.
All right.
Anybody from the public wishing to speak? I'm going to open the public portion of the hearing up at this time. Anybody? Mr. Ash, any comments from you? You're a contractor. Are we on the right road? Okay, thank you, sir.
So moved that we accept the recommendation of approval of this proposed ordinance.
Second.
On the floor and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign, it carries. One more thing, Kevin, if I could. Could we explore the possibility with some of our long-established contractors of using today's technology, of the cameras and the phones and stuff, to do inspections without sending people out to it? We have people that have been in business 40 years. They're not going to shortchange you. Why can't
I understand that. I don't know if state statute really allows.
Well, that's why I said, would you please explore it?
But we can explore it a little
bit. Some other counties are doing it, I can tell you.
I do know of other counties that are doing it, but they're also permitting 3,000 new single-family residences in a month, and
we're soon to be at that number. So
we permitted 5 new homes this week for a total of over 20,000 square feet between all 5 homes.
So you're seeing an uptick.
We're seeing an uptick in permitting.
That's good news.
Super.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you.
All right. Next on the agenda, County Administrator Rick Leary.
Well, these are your appointments, sir.
Okay. You always tell me that. All right. But
for the record, finding an animal service advisory committee member is very difficult.
Well, I'll tell you,
amen.
I'm going to lean on you three and five to get this done because I have the other board members are chomping at the bit to go. Okay.
You got to find them in your district, number one.
That's right.
And then those that are willing to serve.
Well, with your approval, can I do this? Can I go ahead and give the green light with Mr. Hammonds for them to organize? And they're probably going to elect their own chair. It's going to operate more like a county committee than it has in the past.
Yeah, but if you don't have a quorum, even with three and five missing, you've got two at large.
I think we have enough for a quorum. If we do, can we proceed? And I think that will help.
Wouldn't want to hold them back.
Yeah, somebody will come forward once we get rolling.
Maybe we can do some type of press release specifically for this, indicating how important it is to us and that we want it, and see whether some citizens will be stimulated to.
Mr. Hammonds, that sound pretty good?
Yes, sir.
Can we do the press release? All right, very good. We'll do it.
Yep, three and five out, please.
Three and five.
That's right.
Gotcha. All right. Okay. Portable housing? Anybody? Fishing fund? Okay, hearing none. County attorney, Stacy Manning.
It might help for me to get some clarification right now about when the question is called. It's not required under the board's current procedures that the question be voted on with no further discussion. It appears that has maybe been the practice in the policy, but there is no formal requirement of that. As you know, this board follows a modified Roberts Rules of Procedure. and I'm not saying whether that's good or bad. I know many, many counties do that. But for reference purposes, if you were following strict Roberts Rules, if the question is called, it then does require a vote of a majority of the members to actually require that the vote be taken at that point. So just for clarification,
right,
in the future.
We're not following strict Roberts Rules. So in an instant, just a minute ago, Larry wanted a question to you, but Commissioner Flagg called a question. I should have let Larry.
You can't end the debate with asking a question, according to Roberts Rules of Order.
It should be at that, according to Roberts Rules, once the question was called at that point, then it would take a majority of the board to end the debate and vote on the question.
So I should have voted on that to end the debate or the questioning?
According to Roberts Rules as strictly interpreted. But again, this board doesn't necessarily follow that. And
well, the city of Palatka, I've watched many of their meetings, and they operate differently. And Mr. Flagg carried that over to this board, and it's kind of new to me, and that's why I'm.
And you can, and again, it's a policy of the board and how you want to do those things.
I read up on it when Mr. Flagg was elected, because mm-hmm. that's the, you know, the way he operated the city meetings, just to be sure. And I interpreted it that if anybody called a question, it had to go to vote, but we're actually voting on rather to continue the conversation or not.
Right.
Okay, I got it. I'm clear.
Okay.
Sorry.
That's
I apologize,
okay.
Mr. Harvey. Mr. Harris, I'm sorry.
That's okay. I just wanted to talk about that a little bit. I do not like to use calling for the question as a matter of practice. I know it's how the city commission did it, but it does cut everything short. And I don't think we really need to do that. I always want to hear what somebody else has to say. And I would prefer that we just not use that particularly, just as a matter of practice.
How do the rest of you feel?
I like the question.
I think the tool should be used appropriately, not inappropriately. It should not be used to suppress conversation. But when we get bogged down into issues that are not relative to the specifics of what's happening, there comes a time that, to me, the question is not to suppress or to dismiss or to stop, it's to bring us back in check. And the chair has always had the opportunity, if there was dissension among the board at that time, to find out whether or not the board wanted more discussion to come. Not one person, but the chair still had that opportunity. And it's not because one person wanted to speak. The majority of the board decided that we wanted more discussion. So when the question was called, that was not the stop sign or the police officer standing there saying, no more discussion. It was an opportunity for us to be at this crossroad and decide more or less, but it was not necessarily the chair alone, unless it was overridden by the board, is
okay.
My understanding.
Well, Mr. Manning, hear me out and correct me if I'm wrong here. So the desire of this board and the premises that we operate under is a loose version of Robert's rules. So I will take a vote asking my fellow commissioners if we want to continue the conversation. But for the record, if we were following Robert's rules strictly, if a question was called, we'd go to vote on the discussed item.
No, that's what I'm saying. If you follow it strictly, that then the vote would be on whether or not the question
to continue the
discussion or actually to call a question.
For the remainder of my chairmanship, that's exactly what I'll do. If you call question or anybody, we're going to have a vote on it. Very well, I can do that.
On if the discussion
on whether to end debate.
Mm-hmm.
Not on the issue.
Right. I got it. Thank you for the clarification. I can do that.
Sure.
Okay. Anybody else?
Thank you, sir.
All right.
Tim Smith trained me.
Yeah. That's right, former mayor. Did you just hug everybody?
I agree with Mr. Manning.
My pastor says, I know what I said, but I don't know what you heard, right?
Tim, do you have anything else to share with us today?
No.
He's sharing hugs for a dollar now.
Just saying. I don't have any other items, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you.
Did Brandon get a picture of that while he was?
That was good. All right, Commissioner comments. Starting on my left, Commissioner Harris.
I think I've commented enough.
Okay, Commissioner Flagg.
I feel the same.
Commissioner Pelletier.
St. Paul's church annual festival. I don't know how many years it's been.
Fish fry.
It's got to be all over 30. Was this Saturday at Federal Point. Come out and eat oysters and fry.
You cooking oysters?
I think I'm on the fish frying project this week.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, we'll do that, and that certainly is. It's on the banks of the St. John's River at Federal Point.
Very beautiful
setting and one of the older celebrations and certainly worth visiting.
And
Mr. Harvey.
Hold on. Not
done. Oh, we got multiples. Go ahead, sir.
After that, you need to proceed to the great District 5 area of Rodman for the Ed Taylor Save Rodman tournament. I think weigh-in is at 3, and they usually have an excess of 100 or so boats there, and should be a good turnout, a lot of fun.
Okay. There we go.
And U-turn.
I'm done.
U-turn is done.
Oh, I don't know about U-turn.
I got U-turn.
You got it. Okay.
Don't steal my thunder. Right. That's District 2, baby.
All right.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Relay for Life for the Cancer Society is Friday at the fairgrounds, so Friday at 6 o'clock we kick off with skydivers coming in to bring it in, and we'll end Saturday morning at 9 o'clock, so we'll have relay all night long. I would encourage everyone to come out. On April 23rd, we're having a Republican debate at the Rodman Plantation. Everybody is welcome to be there. House District 19, Speaker Designate Richard Corkland. Representative Corkland will be there and moderate the debate, so that will be a good time for the citizens of Putnam County to hear the candidates and choose their candidate, and also for us an opportunity to show Speaker Designate Richard Corkland around Putnam County and all the assets we have. And Mr. Taylor reminded me to ask you to think about your donation for the Rodman Bass Tournament.
As always.
As always. Okay.
Thank you, Commissioner Harvey. U-turn, the event will be this Saturday at the Triangle Park here at the north end of the city, and it's a great event. They basically will feed your whole family a great picnic meal, and you'll hear some great testimony as well as some wonderful music, and hopefully do some good with the current challenges we have with drugs in our community. These people do a great job, and please come support them this Saturday, U-turn. Thank you to everyone today. Any
Anything else from the community or my board members? If not, I'll
so move. We adjourn.
To adjourn. Second. We are adjourned. Thank everybody.
Thank you. No workshop.